as I said, Chem 105, general chemistry. Now, my name is Dr. Scott, Brother Scott. Are there any more syllabuses going around?
Yeah.
Could you hand this up to me?
Anybody else not have a syllabus?
Must be at least one person who doesn't have a syllabus. More syllabus there.
Over here, anybody else need a syllabus? Okay, so we got a syllabus, right? As it mentions here up there at the top, this is a required text. Okay? And it is required. And the sooner you get it, the better off you'll be. Alright? Don't try to delay that. Purchasing the textbook, okay? Get it as soon as you can. It's in the bookstore. I mean, I think they carry it in the bookstore. They kind of don't like to carry it in the bookstore because people can get online for like $10 or something like that, and the bookstore tries to sell it for maybe $25, $30, something like that. Not that it's a huge difference. It's an older textbook, but we keep it old because you need to have the textbook. We used to just keep the brand newest edition, but some people said they couldn't afford it, wouldn't invest in their education, and they would just get lost very quickly. And so we needed to fix that somehow. Alright? So, you need to get the textbook soon. In the library, there are 5 or 6 copies of this on reserve, so that you can go and get those for the days that you're waiting to get your textbook. Now, there's no need to wait. The bookstore price isn't terribly expensive, but if you find yourself in a situation where you have made a mistake, you can use the library's copies. Alright? Who does not have a textbook yet? Raise your hand if you do not have a textbook yet. Okay, so quite a few of you need to make sure you are on top of things, and there will be homework from this textbook for you to practice before Friday's class. So you want to take advantage of that. Okay? So, this is it. Now, I was looking at a list of our majors here. What do we got? We've got people in entrepreneurship. Who's majoring in entrepreneurship? Is that Annika? No.
No.
What's your name?
Sage.
Sage?
I'm an IDS major, but I'm in entrepreneurship and botany.
Okay. So why are you in this class?
Botany to help understand the
chemistry
of plants.
Okay. All right. Great. Quite a few biology, right? Biology with a variety of different minors. Just a couple biochemistry. Let's see. Does anybody want to volunteer that they're a biochem major? All right. 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay. And let's see, Yong Jung, is that right? I know you from Chem 101, you're a biochem major. Brianna, is that right? And let's see, Penelope, no. What's your name?
Sharon.
And?
Okay.
So, now, some of you have minors. I can't quite understand exactly what they're trying to tell you. Mm-hmm. So is biochemistry your major, or is it kind of a minor?
Major.
Right. So what I would recommend is the four of you find an opportunity to sit maybe in these 4 seats or these 4 seats next class before anybody comes in, all right? Because biochem is definitely the hardest major in the sciences and possibly the hardest major on campus, I don't know. But you're gonna need all the help you can get. You wanna find each other and you wanna work together as long as you can. Does that make sense? Okay? I mean, I don't know if it's the hardest on campus. I don't know about that. I think that, what else would be hard on campus? Anyway, I'm sure there's something that's almost as hard if not. Okay. Let's see. Here we go. Let's see what else we got. EXS major. Raise your hand if you're an EXS major. Alright. So if you're an EXS major, make sure you need to take this class. I don't know how the requirements are changing and such, There's a Chem 101 that's a lot easier than this class, all right? And it's taught in the fall for sure. I'm not sure if they're going to teach it in the spring or what, but just make sure that this is the class for you. Everybody should make sure that this is the class for them, because this is a very hard class. And a lot of people tell me it's really boring, right? So people have trouble showing up. And while we're talking about showing up, let me look at the attendance here. I've tried all sorts of things in terms of trying to help people come to class, get points for coming to class. And if you give points for coming to class, people come to class and they tune out. They tune out, or they sleep, or just that's it. So the points for coming to class doesn't help, all right? In my experience, I mean, I've done this again a lot of times. So I just noted here that the statistics suggest that if you miss 5 classes, you will probably find yourself in the D range. All right, in the D range. You're not going to get any points for not coming or for coming to class. So that's it. Right? But statistically, if you miss 5 classes, that either represents something along with your commitment, you changed your mind, or something. That, or I think more so, it's probably you get behind. You miss a couple classes, you get behind, you can't figure out what's going on in class, and then you show up, and that just results in poor test scores. Okay? But if you miss 10 classes, I mean, that's it, right? You're not going to, statistically. Now, it's very possible somebody in here already knows this information from a previous life or experience, right? And they could take these exams without having to show up to class. I'm not going to feel bad if you don't show up to class, because that's you, right? And you'll have a couple of opportunities to, it's not a good choice, but I know that there are some really smart people here at great high school chemistry, what they are. So, I'm not going to talk to people about, hey, why aren't you showing up? That's what I'm not doing. Need some time to talk about this, I'm not going to be monitoring your attendance, okay? So no points there. Homework. Same thing. I'm going to provide homework questions for you. Every class period, there's going to be a range of homework questions that you will kind of be responsible for understanding. And there will be some questions to answer on Canvas, okay? But there's no points associated with any of that, all right? So that's just your own check to see how things are going, okay? Now, I don't know how many times people say, I understand what's going on, but I can't get these questions right. You see a lot of people get up for, I'm here to try out, what's your dream? I want to be the next American Idol. Okay, we'll sing this song. If you want to go to London, and everybody's just aghast. This person thought they had talent. What? They were so far removed from reality. They are horrible. Right? Why didn't somebody say, "Oh no, don't do it"? What happened there? Right? I mean, if that can happen with something as obvious as vocalizing a loud tone that sounds horrible, I mean, is it possible that you're confused about understanding the intricacies of a chemistry question? Yes, it's very possible. I mean, people say, I'm just not a good test taker. You don't understand the material. It takes a long time to understand the material. It takes a long time to practice the material. It's absolutely doable. We're going to give you all the tools you need here. But don't think to yourself, oh, I skimmed through those questions, I got them, right? If you don't get the questions right on the homework, you don't understand the material. Okay? So that's there for your check. That's there for your check. If you ignore that check, you take the questions for the first 3 chapters, you do, 50% type thing, you take the exam and you find yourself in the, scoring maybe a 30% on the exam, you're in big trouble. Because you're already 2 chapters in, 2 or 3 chapters in, and you don't have a foundation to work from. So you'll be slipping the whole way through. So you have to start immediately trying to identify what's going on. I do have another way to get points besides exams, though. It's extra credit. Extra credit. So this semester, I'm going to try something that I've never done before. I'm going to give you an extra credit point for every time that you go visit the tutors. Right? So you go and visit the tutors, interact with them, and you convince them that they're going to give you an extra credit point. And they're going to be the ones that are doing it. So you're not going to tell me, hey, I was there, but they didn't write me down, blah, blah, blah. The tutors are the ones who are going to record your points. Okay? So if you come to them and say, hey, I was over there studying for a half hour, can you give me a point? They might say, oh, I'm not giving you a point today. You're going to have to interact with them, make sure that they're actually teaching you something, and that they feel like they have tested you some way or gone over some problems with you. And so then you can say, hey, can you give me that point? Yeah, I'll give you that point. Okay? But that'll be an extra credit point. Now, there's about 60 days in the semester, plus or minus 5, I don't know. Just class days, right? So that's a total of about 60 points. If you take 60 points divided by the total points possible from your exams, and that's the only other way to get points, 330, what's 60 divided by 330? A little less than, 12%, is that right? Oh, sorry, it's about 18%. Is that right? I think it's around, you know, it's reasonably expected, maybe 10 to 15%, 10 to 15%, that it'll augment your score if you were to do what?
Visit the tutor
every day. Right? Now, it doesn't need to be prolonged. It can be 15 minutes, right? You're going to have to work with that tutor. But how does 15% affect your grade here? Look at the grade scale. The exams are multiple choice, so if you put A on every single thing, you should leave here with what?
25%.
25%. Right? So if you have the thoughts, I'm just going to put A on every single exam question, and I'm going to go to the tutor every day, right? You should be able to escape with what?
40%.
Maybe. 40%? No. I think it's more about 15%. Right? So you get around the 40%. So that's a C minus. Alright, so there's a game plan for those of you who are frightened to death, right? Alright, and C minus is passing for many majors. I'm not sure about specifically the one you're in. Okay? But here's the crazy thing. If you do that with the tutor every day like that, you're going to start learning the stuff. You're going to start learning the material, and you will you'll end up doing a lot better than that. Okay? So, the way that we are going to generally get points, besides the tutors, I mean, again, that's extra credit. Those points aren't included in here. But are the exams. The exams. Okay? And we're going to try to get in as many exams as possible. We have three scheduled. If we could get four and then the final, that would be great. Three midterms and then the final would be good. If we could get four and a final, that would be better. The exam is a standardized national American Chemical Society exam. So all the exams, all the midterms and all the exams are these standardized exams. So when you take it, you're comparing yourself to the nation, the United States of America. But in reality, the American Chemical Society is probably the most noted chemical society in the world, so it's a real comparison to the world in terms of what kinds of chemistry you have. Does that make sense? Oh, man, it's not a pen to be seen. You gotta be kidding me. Is there a piece of chalk over there?
Oh, wait, wait, wait. I just started storing stuff in here.
Not even there, even? All right, let me see that chalk. Watch this, gentle people. Anybody taking statistics ever? In statistics, you have this phenomenon, right? Called basically a standard deviation from an average, right? And this is a phenomenon that results in nature, in physical things, almost anything. If we took the average height of a person, there would be an average height, and then there would be a distribution like this if we got enough people. If you take the height of 10 people, you would see just like 10 spots along this curve. That make sense? But if you took the spot, the height of everybody, it would make a perfect curve like this. That make sense? If you took a light bulb and wanted to ask how long the light bulb was going to last, right? You would have the exact same curve result. So this is something that happens whenever there's a true value or an average value and then outliers or any standard deviation of any significant amount. Okay? If this value, the distance here and the distance here, need to be equal to identify what the true deviation is. That make sense? If you have some sort of a value that has an artificial wall right there, an artificial wall, and you'll get the first half of the deviation, but the second half you won't be able to get because some sort of artificial barrier that prevents something. This is an example of this is maybe throwing a rock at a wall. How close can you get that rock to the wall? Well, you'll never be able to get it past the wall. And so there will be some sort of a deviation like that. Unfortunately, another example of this sort of a setup is when you have your average exam score be 75%. Now, this has just kind of been customary and things work their way through the academic system, so that 75% means a C or an average score. Well, if that's the case, 75% is closer than 100 than 0 is, right? And so you cannot get a standard deviation or a statistical evaluation to determine whether or not that test actually shows the performance, an average performance or anything, because you don't know what the top is. That makes sense? So all standardized exams have an average of not 75%, but 50%. That makes sense? So when you take the standard exam, now what score should you get, even if you're a machine or a monkey or anything? 25%, right? Because if you just put in random dots, you should expect to get about 25%. That makes sense? So you just need to push yourself up to 50%, and then that will make you average. Now, what do you get if you get 50% in terms of a grade in this class? 50% is a C. If you can get a 52%, C plus, 54%, B minus, right? If you can get a 60% on the exam, then you're almost up to a B plus, right? 70% on the exam, and that's, whoops, what happened there? What's going on? Is anybody else? Everybody else looks like that? What in the world? Okay, anyway, this is 70% and above is an A. Okay? What's that? Not impossible. A lot of people get it. A lot of people mean, 5 or 6. Okay. So, an A in the class, especially with the tutoring, right? If you want an A in the class, but you have to score it, you go to half the tutoring, let's say. If you want an A in the class, let's say you want 70%, you can do half the tutoring, let's say that's going to give you 7%, you need to look at getting a 63% on the exam. Is that true? Okay. And if you go to all the tutoring, you lower yourself down to maybe a 55% on the exam if you go to all the tutoring. Okay? I believe in the tutoring. I know it works. When we don't offer any credit for it, any extra credit, any class credit, people who go to the tutoring succeed very well. When we start offering credit, it doesn't work. And so I'm wondering if you just offer extra credit. Yes, sir.
Is how do you schedule tutoring?
Is there, say it again? Schedule tutoring. There's just a room at the end of this hallway on the right. It's room 133.
Okay.
And they should be there every weekday, 5 to 9, 5 to 10 about. All right? Okay. Now, I don't know how long it's going to take them to get started this semester. They might be not there the first 4 days of the semester. I'm not sure. But we'll figure something out. and I will email you as soon as I know. I'm already looking into it, so I'll email you as soon as I know. Yes?
Is there other extra credit?
Oh, like last time? That might happen. That might happen. I don't know. I mean, sometimes I see a symposium or a seminar, and I think, wow, this is really good for any student who's going to be a science major. And so I invite you to come, and I give you a point extra credit. I don't know those this far ahead. Okay, so we talked about the exams. One thing we didn't mention about the exams, though, is that each exam is a booklet, right? You get this little booklet, and it has questions for half the book, which is this whole semester, right? But each time we take the exam, we won't have the information from half the book. We only have the information from the chapters that we covered. And so there will only be a handful of questions to answer the first exam, right? Maybe 10. Second exam, we'll probably have about 20. The third exam, we'll get maybe 40. And then depending on where we are, the class exam, we'll have 70 questions, okay? Final, right? So each time you take it, it's like you're taking a chunk of it. It's never the same exam. Does that make sense? It's not the same booklet. So don't think that you can look through the questions and try to improve your chances or anything like that. It's not like that. Each time you take it, though, it's kind of like a practice. So, oh man, still no pen. If you score, for example, this is chalk for it. If you score 30% on the first exam, okay? Exam one. And then exam two, you score 40%. Exam two contained the same information that exam one scored, right? So the only way you put about 40% is because you started to figure some stuff out. Does that make sense? So this really represents what you probably would get on exam one if you were to take it again. And so we'll change that score to a 40%. Does that make sense? If you take it the third time and you get 50%, then all three of these will be 50%, right? If you take the final and you score 45%, right, then if this was your lineup, you would get 50, 50, and these are percentages, and then 45. Does that make sense? Don't relax. It doesn't make any sense. Okay? All right, does that make sense? So if you can get 60% on the final, then essentially you're winning 60% of all the points. Right. So whatever your grade is on the final, that is how many points you can expect if that's your highest grade. Okay? Now, you cannot let up. Sometimes people score 80% on that first exam. One thing that's crazy about, it's kind of awful. If you score 80% on the first exam, the only direction you go is down, right? So that usually happens, right?
You've got to pace yourself, right?
I don't know if you pace yourself or just not give up because you think you understand it the first time. And that's usually the trend. Trend usually does go down. Even if you start off at 30% of 4 points. We're start right, first chapter, and work our way there. Okay. Anything else we're missing? Tutoring, yes. And that'll be sometime this afternoon. Alright? And we'll try to figure something out so that people can get to tutoring tonight. So. Okay? Alright. Another thing I'm going to emphasize right now is a calculator. Alright? Same thing applies with the calculator that we talked about with the book. Some people say, well, I got my phone, I got this little thing that my grandpa used, I got whatever, steal from my roommate. Just get a calculator, okay? Get a calculator and get it soon. And then once you get that calculator, and so this is again a statistical thing, I've seen an amazing thing happen. If people built a good relationship with their calculator, they do well in the class. They do well. No, this never happens anymore because I remind people of this. But here's the final. We're all here. I hand out all the exams. I sit down. Great, you got 2 hours. All right, I sit down. Somebody raises their hand. Can I borrow a calculator? I can always Oh, you're going to get a D. You might as well be. You're done. It just happens. If they're borrowing a calculator at that stage in the game, there's no way they're going to. And I used to say, yeah, sure, here you go. Not anymore. You have to find your own calculator and be a big boy or girl. Why not how to make it work? Get the batteries in there and do all the things. Oh, it got stolen. It got stolen on the way here. You got mugged. What happened? Get yourself a calculator. Because the statistics say if you raise your hand and ask to borrow a calculator, you're going to do very poor on the exam because you've not had that relationship with your calculator. And you need to know how to use your calculator very well. Okay? If you get a good calculator like this, it can save you a ton of time in terms of solving some of those questions as well. So don't get, you can do absolutely anything you want. You can do anything you want, and you will, right? Lots of options out there. I would just get some sort of scientific calculator like this, it'll have everything you need. For sure, on an exam, you can't use your phone, all right? So that's one thing that if you decide, I'll use the calculator sometime, use my phone for the first half of the class, or just be ready for me saying, okay, no phones in the test. All right? So, book and calculator, just get it right away. It's so minuscule of an investment compared to the return throughout your life. Right? All right. At the end of that, I think that's about all that we have to talk about in terms of this course. Is there any other questions?
Where can you find those quiz problems for Friday?
Oh yeah, we gotta talk about that. Could you give me a black pen? Thank you. Where are we at?
29.
Oh, you can stop.
Stop it?
Yeah. All right. So, the quiz questions, especially the ones that are gonna be kind of, because they only open for a small amount of time. The quiz questions, specifically for Friday, for example, this Friday, January 12th, there are going to be some quiz questions that are going to be open, and they close at the beginning of class, all right? They're going to be on problems. Can everybody see on the slide where it says what problems they're on? Somebody help me out. What problems are they on? 130 to 136, right? And that course corresponds to the back of the chapter, all right? Not the review questions, all right? But the review problems, okay? The review problems. Number 130 to 136. 130 to 136. Where's 136? Okay? And of those problems, the ones that I'm going to take are the blue problems, okay? I'm gonna take the blue problems. I take the blue problems because blue problems are what?
Answers
in the back of the book. That make sense? Answers in the back of the book, okay? So, 130 to 136, blue problems, answers in the back of the book. On the quiz, or the practice, there's only gonna be two questions, all right? There's just two questions. And they're going to tell you how well you do by you trying to answer those questions, right? How well you gather the information from these problems. Okay? So that's how that's going to work. Does everybody understand that? That's on Canvas. One other thing that's going to be on Canvas is a video of somebody solving every group blue problem. Does that make sense? So there'll be somebody solving the blue problems on a link to it. YouTube video or some solving problem. So you are up against problem 134. You're like, what? I don't understand this problem. Right? You went to the tutor, they're not there, whatever. You can go to the videos, right? And now, so the no problem pen still. Hey, thank you, man. Alright. So video looks like this sort of thing. Usually up on the right-hand corner of the board that they're working on, it'll say the problem number. So you can scroll through it, find the right problem, right? And just watch and solve it and see if that helps. That make sense? Okay. Did you have a question back there?
Yeah. Would you recommend like graphing calculator or just kidding?
We don't need to actually graph, but I don't think that scientific calculators that have functions we need don't do that. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. So usually that's a telltale sign that works. So graphing calculator is probably good. This is a TI-84. They have like TI-86, 89, 82 is probably okay as well. A TI-82 through 4, I'm not sure exactly how low you can go. In general, if it just kind of looks like this, that'll be fine. Okay? And older ones you can get on eBay or wherever for pretty cheap now, right? And there will be a couple of class periods, maybe even a week, where it's not absolutely required, right? So, yeah, you'll have some time if you want to order it. Okay. Okay. Let's see. Anything else? Yeah?
As far as like reading or preparing
yes.
for the class, do we read just like what the quiz is going to be on?
I think that's best. So if I was going to prepare myself for 130 to 134, right, I would try to identify the sections that pertain to it. Now, some of you are great readers. That is awesome. I knew this one of my colleagues at University of Hawaii would read like crazy, and I was shocked that they could read so much. But I was also really surprised that they didn't really retain very much. So, man, I was really depressed because I'm not a good reader, and then to realize that you have to read and retain, right? And you know, if somebody asks me to read this kind of thing, holy cow, right, a chemistry book? So some people are really good at reading cover to cover and getting absolutely everything out of it. That's not me. So my style is not a good style, not a good model to follow probably. But I look at the problems and then I go searching for the answers in the book. Does that make sense? Now some people are really good readers and they'll be, well, retention there as well, so yeah. And if I try to read this sort of thing, what do you think happens? I fall asleep. That's right. I literally fall asleep, right? And that's hard. Okay. Any other questions? Yes.
So the homework. So basically, when we have in the book, the blue questions, those are just to prepare us for the homework that we have on Canvas.
No. Well, that's right.
Yeah. And so the homework on Canvas is homework that we need to do an hour before class. But I don't see it on the grade rubric. So basically,
so you don't need to do
so,
it.
So basically, we don't need to do it, but it's going to help us prepare us for the exam, if that's correct.
It's going to always allow you to check yourself and then check your studies and see how it goes.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean, because some people already know this stuff. They're dragged down. They're mad that they're in this class that's still repeating. That's an opportunity for them to.
So then those quizzes are on Canvas as well?
No, you take them before you get to classes. They're timed though, so you need to have, you can't look at the quiz in the on Canvas, and you won't have time to search through the book. Does that make sense? You need to know the information. Quizzes are timed. It just blows up, right? I mean, do makes it sound like there's some points associated with it that you're going to take home and put on the there are points that will show them on Canvas, but that has nothing to do with your grade.
Yeah. Would you usually open them up?
Try to open them up.
The day of?
Yeah, right, right after class. So.
Okay, so like we could do it tomorrow.
What's that?
We could do them tomorrow, essentially.
Oh, yeah, you should
don't
do them tonight.
The day of.
No, tonight, yeah. I should try to, after this class, I should get to sit down and open them up. Noon or all right. So, we have 10 good minutes. This class, we cannot waste one bit of time, okay? We won't even get to the end of what we need to have for the standardized exam, so Take one of these, there should be a ton extra because this is for both classes. So, we're going to start talking about chemistry. Alright? I'll forego my introduction to wow you with my skills. Tell you about my PhD, my postdoc, my dissertation, my research. You'll just have to believe me, I guess. Okay. It differs from things like democracy, philosophy, religion, which from a scientific method perspective are all the same word. That makes sense? Religion is basically a bunch of people who get together and decide. It could be led by God or whatever, but they're still all voting. Philosophy, same thing. Democracy, obviously, that's the definition of the word, right? Scientific method needs to be some sort of a pattern, right? You do something, and because of the results, you're bound. You have to do something else. If you do the exact same thing this way, then you always get this exact same result, right? So, we observe, we collect data. We make an hypothesis, and we try to make an experiment from that hypothesis, right? The experiments that we do, if it's the exact same experiment every time, we should get the same result every time, right? If the experiment doesn't work out, right, then it doesn't mean that there's no such thing as the experiment didn't work out. It just means it didn't work out what? Did the experiment here work out? If I give him some bread, he's going to eat the bread, right? So we gave him the bread, it just sticks on his head. Did the experiment work out? It worked, but what? I was wrong about my prediction, right? Right? Now, you guys will slowly get out of that, but so many people love to say the phrase, whether it's in a lab write-up or in their research, my hypothesis was correct, right? As if that's an indication of something, right? A sign that you were a natural-born scientist or something like that, right? Experiments should always give you data to recollect and perform the experiment again or in a different way. Right? Observations lead to models. Models. Almost everything we ever talk about is a model of some sort in this class when we're talking about chemistry, biology. Everything is a model, right? When the great end of everything happens, and we can see through everything, and we know exactly how things work, all of these models will just be useless. And we'll have different ways in which we explain things that happen. And if one ever have to explain on a molecular level, I don't know. But it's important to remember, because if you ever feel like, oh, this can't be right because it's supposed to follow this model, then you'll always be stuck in the model, right? You have to recognize that everything's a model. This model here of the atom is a model, meaning that it's what?
It's a representation.
Yeah, it is probably limited in many ways. It's probably more limited than it is enabling. But for our level of technology, it's more enabling than it is limited. Does that make sense? In the real realm of things, though, this probably makes no sense in terms of what's going on. But it's a model that works great for us. We teach you later on, chapter 9 or 10, that this model is messed up, right? But we still go back and use it again because it enables us to solve problems. Okay? Theories are collections of these models, collections of these ideas. Theory, when you hear the word theory used outside of the science class, people think it's theoretical. Theory meaning not proven. Likely not the way things are. But that's not what a theory is here. Theories are essentially models that people haven't been able to break out of to find any other way to explain or a better way to explain what's going on. So theories are pretty strong. All right? Laws are when a theory gets its own kind of mathematical statement. For example, pressure in a balloon, for example, could be related to pressure related to some constant, you can call it 1, over the volume, right? So if I increase the pressure around the balloon, if this number gets bigger, what does this number have to do? It has to get smaller so that statement can be true, right? So let me draw that for you. Here I have a balloon. I'm increasing the pressure around the balloon. We know that that would make the balloon smaller, right? Here's a law that states that. Does that make sense? Okay, so laws generally have their equations associated with them. Chemistry influences absolutely everything. I got into chemistry because it's kind of like the end of the questions, right? What happened to that building over there? It fell down. Well, why didn't it fall down? Oh, because the structure wasn't strong. But why wasn't the structure strong? Oh, because somebody poured the cement wrong. Well, why did that make a difference? You can keep asking until you get to a level. The molecular bonding didn't occur because he used resin A and 10% more than he should have. Got it. We know how to fix it. Right? What happened to the building? It fell down. Oh, make a stronger building. Oh, there's the answer. Go. Right? That's not the answer. Right? Yeah, you need a stronger building, but you don't know how. Right? The answer always seems to be at the chemical level. All right? And so it does influence everything. And its influence is growing as well. All right. We're going to try to go and collect some vocabulary words as we go. One of them is mass. All right? Mass is what anything that is materialistic, that matter has mass, right? It's what we kind of talk about when something weighs a certain amount. And, you know, for a while, we try to distinguish between weight and mass. We try to make sure we use the word mass, right? But even on the chemicals that they sell, they'll use the word weight sometimes, all right? It's not a huge deal, except for that weight is a measurement of a force, and weight is related to the gravity, right? So here's the moon, and here's the earth, right? If I stand on a scale here on the moon, and I weigh 100 pounds, how much am I going to weigh on the earth? 600 pounds, all right? That scale is going to be 6 times as much on the earth. If I stand on this sort of thing here, and I have a 100-pound mass that's balancing me, and then I take this over to the Earth, how much of a mass am I going to need on the Earth? Just the 100 pounds still. Here, I'm measuring my weight. That arrow represents gravity pulling it down, right? Here, Earth has much stronger gravity, but it's going to influence both things, right? So this one is identifying my weight or my mass? Mass, right? Whereas a scale, generally a scale works off of some sort of a spring, and how far the spring is pressed down relates to, we say it's the mass, right? In the lab, it doesn't matter because we're always on Earth, so. But they kind of want you to make sure you understand when you say weight and mass, that you really mean mass. And if you really want to use the word weight, then you make sure you distinguish them. Okay. Some more words that we need to kind of gain a grasp of. All right? Atom. Atom. What's in the nucleus of an atom? Protons, what kind of a charge?
Positive
charge. And then neutrons?
Neutral.
Neutral, not negative. Unfortunately, neutron sounds like negative. All right, neutral charge. 3 positive charges in my nucleus here. 1 neutral charge for now. Electrons are on the outside, right? We'll draw 3 of them here. All right, here's our model, right? 3 protons, 3 electrons. And generally, that's how atoms come. Same number of what? Same number of protons and electrons, right? This specific atom can be identified. because the number of protons corresponds to its number on the periodic table. Top left number, where are we at? Lithium. Can you see that on the periodic table? Number three. Three what? What's that three stand for? Protons. And essentially also what? Electrons. If the atom is neutrally charged. There's no charge here because it has the same number of what? Protons and electrons. All right, that's a good start for now. So we'll see you on Friday. Look for some email. Identifying that what the computer is doing and the hand space will be served together.
Is the last one?